everyone, and welcome to the Zapbox session here at Zappar AR Pioneers. I'm Kirk Ewing, GM of Zapbox, and I'm going to be your host for today here in my lovely virtual box within a slideshow within a window. Coming up soon, we're going to have the man himself, the Lord of Latency, Mr. Zapbox, aka Dr. Simon Taylor, talking us through the latest announcements and drilling into the details about what to expect in the box when you receive your very own mixed reality Zapbox headset in the imminent future. Now, as a co-founder of Zapper, I just wanted to start by remembering for a second the journey we've all had to get to this exact moment here. It's actually been 11 years since Simon, Connell, Casper, and myself got together like some really badly dressed student band and, armed only with Simon's vision algorithm and a dream, tried to bring mobile AR to the world. Nowadays, that effort is supported by the collective brilliance of the Zapper family, and we remain the upstarts in the global VR AR marketplace, working in force to democratize AR and now mixed reality, and to utilize mobile computing to make something magical. I don't honestly think any of us could have predicted 11 years ago what was going to happen in the marketplace over that period. We've clearly grown as a business, and over time, we've learned to swim with bigger and bigger sharks. So I guess on reflection, I should really start by saying thanks, Mark Zuckerberg and others, for raising awareness of what's possible in this space, but still leaving the door open for the little guy too. Okay, nostalgia over. Let's get to the main event, the Zapbox session. I'm going to hand over to Dr. Simon now to tell us all the latest news about what's in the box, and I'll be back later to talk about the content pipeline and what you've got to look forward to. So, Doctor, are you ready?
Ready enough. Google Drive's finished converting things, so let's go for it. I am going to start with a bit more nostalgia again. So just very briefly, the history of Zapbox itself and how we got here. So obviously the latest wave of VR started around 2012 with Oculus, the very first kind of PC connected Oculus headsets. Google Cardboard came out and showed that we could do kind of similar things with a smartphone. And we were really inspired by that. And so we built a Cardboard mixed reality viewer back in 2016. So it was a Google Cardboard headset, and it had some more Cardboard peripherals, which could be fully tracked. And it allowed lots more people to get involved in fully tracked mixed reality with fully tracked controllers. And so that was a really nice product. We made it a bit thinner in 2018 with a flat pack version. And it was sort of kind of felt too good for Cardboard in the end. Like, the quality of the experience you got was really surprising to most people who tried it. And the Cardboard, the kind of physical product, was the thing that seemed to let it down slightly. And so we went back to the drawing board a bit and completely from the ground up rethought the physical product for Zapbox. So how can we make smartphone-powered mixed reality affordable, accessible to all? And this is what we came up with. So this is our all-new Zapbox, as we called it on the Kickstarter campaign for this version. Most affordable, six-DOF, fully tracked headset, including now two fully tracked controllers as well. This is an upgrade from the Kickstarter campaign, even because the controllers were going to be passive. They're now fully electronic. We'll get more into that in a second. Supports iOS and Android. There are some devices that are going to be better than others, but in general, we try and support all devices as well as we can, given the hardware on there. We offer full color pass through mixed reality, a bit like the Quest Pro that you might have seen recently. But we've got this very extremely open peripheral design that's very new with this device this time around, which gives you a lot more comfort and you feel much more anchored in the real world as well as being present in the virtual world. And it's a really nice balance between field of view for content, but still feeling like you can comfortably sort of navigate your real world environment without bumping into things. VR experiences work as well. It's actually a really nice way of viewing just all of the 360 video content that's out there and Google Cardboard type apps that already exist. But primarily, mixed reality, multi-user experiences are where it's at for Zapbox. We're offering a Unity SDK this time around as well, which is going to make content creation accessible to a much wider group of developers. And our first sort of developer launch phase is going to be in Q1 next year. Kirk is going to talk a bit more about that later on. So drilling into the details of the product a bit more, here's the the headset design. So head strap with a ratchet on the back to adjust it for your own particular head size. The glasses element can slide out a bit. There's around about 100 degree horizontal field of view. It depends a little bit on how close the lenses are to your eyes, whether you've got glasses on, for example, how big your device is. But generally, kind of 50 degrees outwards is about what you get on most devices. IPD is fixed, like in most cardboard viewers or Daydream. And phones can simply slip in to the phone grips there and are held really quite securely. So that's the headset. And then we move on to the controllers, which are fully custom designed for Zapbox. They've got all the same inputs that you would get on a Quest, which it makes kind of porting content that also exists on Quests easier because you don't have to rethink all of your input mappings. So we've got a joystick there, two kind of active buttons on each controller and the menu button, a trigger around the back and a grip switch around the side. The grip switch isn't analog, it's digital. That's the only input difference from Quest. But this whole setup of inputs is really quite standard now across the VR ecosystem. So PSVR2 has a very similar set. And so going with these inputs hopefully will make it easier to get content that's also going to be compatible with Zapbox. This is inside, so fully custom again, PCB. We've got an IMU in there, so a motion sensor, accelerometer, and gyroscope, which can help us track more rapid motion of the controller and also mean when it's out of the field of view of the camera, you would still get orientation updates as you move the controller around. It connects to both iOS and Android via standard Bluetooth. They're Bluetooth low energy peripherals, so supported on basically all phones now. We also have these things that we call world anchors. So this is how we represent the origin of the space where your content is going to appear. So you can place down an anchor and that's going to be the origin of the content. It means for multi-user experiences, you don't have to do the awkward thing of standing right next to each other and trying to reset your view into the same place. It just automatically comes from the use of anchors. Alongside these world anchors, we have full world tracking support, which is one of our computer vision algorithms that we're constantly refining. And so that will allow kind of freeform movement even when the anchors aren't in view. It's one of those things on the roadmap that's going to continue to improve as we keep working on the software side. You can also see here there's a fisheye lens included in the box. So that increases the camera field of view on the device to be a better match for the VR field of view and also to give you a wider range of motion that we can fully track the controllers. On a lot of devices, so iPhone 11 and later on the iOS side in particular, they've all got ultra-wide cameras on board now. And they're really nice ultra-wide cameras on the iPhone side. So they support 60 FPS. They support manual exposure control. And so those two things mean on those devices, we won't need the fisheye adapter and setup is super simple. You just slip your device in and you're off. Many Android devices also have ultra-wide lenses now as well, ultra-wide cameras. Quite often they're not as fully featured as the main camera. And so it's going to be a bit device specific if you would want to use the main camera with the adapter or if you want to use the native ultra-wide and enjoy the easier setup. We'll make both options available in the app. So it's all packaged and these are real. There's one here. They exist. We've had the first batch made. There is stock now in the US and in the UK and making its way into warehouses in Germany for EU fulfillment. And so we're getting very close now to shipping these first units out to our Kickstarter backers and pre-order backers. You can see there's a small amount of assembly required just to keep it flatter for shipping and storage. So you slide the glasses element into the headset, but that's really it then. Everything else is ready to go once you've inserted your batteries into the controllers, batteries not included. But then, yeah, once you put the headset together, slip in the phone, stick your marker down, and you're ready to experience mixed reality content. This is the bit where, you remember that Steve Ballmer video? It turns out to be the parody that he did in 1986, but everyone thinks it's real. Like, how much would you pay for Windows with Reversi and Reversi? $1,000, etc. This is my fear. So this is our announcement of the retail price. Remember, you've got your two controllers, fully active controllers, Quest compatible inputs. You've got all the great Zapbox runtime software stack that I'm going to be showing you soon. You've got the fisheye lens adapter, $1,000, $500. No, $79.99 plus taxes and shipping. That's the end of my caveats. But there you go. That's our launch pricing when we're launching this in our developer launch phase next year. Quest Pro, I thought, was an interesting thing to talk about, because when we went on this journey with our Zapbox product design, we tried out kind of opening up the peripheral view, and we found it just such a nice step forward in terms of user comfort and how easily people found it to put it on and to sort of adjust to the difference in environment. And it's interesting that Meta have gone the same route a little bit, that they've, with their Pro headset, they've actually made it sort of less immersive and slightly more mixed reality. And I think one of the reasons for that is that although immersion is great, maybe it isn't the holy grail, because in the end, you're still having these experiences in the real world. And there's a certain amount of user discomfort about you don't know what's around you when you're interacting with things. And also there's a certain amount of danger, which brings me neatly onto this video of Stu, our lead designer in a Quest, and his wonderful pug, Doug, who was entirely unharmed in the making of this video, but just shows that being completely cut off from what's going on around you is not necessarily a thing that users are particularly happy to do. Quest Pro's obviously got full color pass-through and more than 20 times the price of Zapbox. So I won't play again. So we can have a kind of look of where Zapbox sits in the landscape of HMD. So there's a kind of spectrum of virtuality along the x-axis here. So things that are just kind of cameras. So things like Snap Spectacles, more AR devices using separate screens. So we've got Nreal Light in there as well, because that's not really tracked. That's just showing an optically kind of see-through display on top of like a big screen that hovers on top of your vision. Obviously things like iPhone for AR kit. Mixed reality, the price points generally are pretty high. So HoloLens and Magic Leap 2 are both optical see-through, optically combined designs. And then Quest Pro is the new kid on the block that's gone video pass-through at that $1,500 price point. So Zapbox kind of sits mainly here. I put it kind of towards the virtual reality segment because it's kind of both, but mixed reality is kind of the core of the product. And just, there you go, $79.99. Kind of there's nothing with that set of features in that at that kind of price point. And then VR Quest with its price bump recently back up to $400 again. So that's five times. So standard Quest is five times the price of Zapbox. So we think there's this really interesting niche here to still offer, you know, fully Quest compatible controllers, full 6DoF tracking, but to leverage people's existing smartphones and offer as good an experience as we possibly can, given that the hardware isn't specifically designed for VR, but to really push the experience as far as we can on a smartphone and offer it for five times cheaper than anything else on the market. Yeah, a few more details here. So yeah, controllers and hand tracking are the way most of these operate. And the kind of Quest Pro difference there is mainly between being primarily VR or MR. And then there's some interesting things around logins, and obviously Meta, being Meta, are very keen to log you in all the time and track everything you're doing so they can market other things to you that you might be interested in. That's not what we're interested in particularly. We want you to buy a product that you want, and then we don't really care what you do with it so much. And so there's no login here. We're not making our own operating system, I guess, is the key. So because we're running on top of iOS and Android, you can do enterprise distribution of in-house apps in the same way you would do for other iOS and Android apps. You can publish apps to the App Store and charge for them if you want, using RSDK. So it's a more, I wouldn't call it open because it's Apple and Google's closed ecosystems. But from our point of view, you know, we're not tracking you. We don't care what you do with it. You don't have to log in to Zapbox to use it. And it's using these devices that are already kind of trusted in the enterprise. So there's some interesting benefits there for a smartphone-based VR deployment. This is my desk just next door, didn't have time to tidy it. So these are all very, very much hot off the press videos, but just to show that we are making really good progress now on the software side as well. So is there a controller around it? See if there's one in the spots. So the tracking's so good, you can't really see the controller in this one. So I'll just show you what we're looking at here. So here's one of the real controllers. You can see all the inputs there, and then we're rendering the cylinder there on top, extruded hexagon, to show the tracking. And so this is recorded on iOS. This is an iPhone 12 Pro. I should say the lighting was good here. So because we're visually tracking, ideally to lower blur, we want small exposures, which means good lighting is helpful. But this shows where we're at now with our current work in progress code, and it's definitely usable, I would say, to be slightly self-effacing about it. It's looking pretty good. Great work, by the way, to Jordan, who's done most of the recent work on controller tracking here. So that's that bit. There's another part that's really important, actually, for comfort, which is something we didn't really do properly with our cardboard version, and that I'm very keen to do right this time. And that's around the latency of the camera feed. And so this first video, you can just say I've got the iOS camera app open here. So this is the native iOS camera app, just to give a sense of how much latency there usually is in a camera view on an app. I'll just play through that. So you can see it in a couple of different ways there, that both in terms of the kind of pure latency from moving my hand in the world to it appearing on screen was quite high, but then also as you move the device around, because of the latency of the rendering, the whole world seems to wobble, and that leads to some discomfort in the app when you're using it. So one of the big bits of work we've been doing is to improve that latency of rendering, and this is now showing our kind of work in progress runtime here. You might notice towards the top end of the screen, there's a bit of a kind of shimmering line, which is where the rendering starts. That's because we're rendering so late, it's a little bit too late. It needs to be a couple of milliseconds earlier, but that's fine. So that is more right now just to show us that it's working and doing the right thing. So by rendering as late as we possibly can, that shaves off about 30, 35 milliseconds of latency from your standard pipeline, which you can see when I, in a second, move my hand, you'll see there's a lot less latency in that being reflected. But then the other thing we can do, because we have motion data from the device that is actually very, very low latency, we can also correct for any motion that the user's making since the point that the camera frame is captured. And that's what we show coming up now, where I can rotate the device actually quite fast and the world still looks pretty solid through that camera view. So that's where we're at on the low latency rendering front. There's a little bit more to do to plumb it together and to render for the two different left and right stereo views, but we're definitely making good progress there, expecting to get to a usable build of this in the next week or two. And then on the other side, we've got, what about the content developer story? And Shubham has been doing great work on this for us on the Unity side. So this is this is a Unity project using our kind of work in progress Unity XR provider plugin. And the content we're going to be seeing here is pretty much Unity standard XR interaction framework demo content. So this just shows that by just swapping the provider plugin over, you can kind of use Unity content that can target other devices as well and build it for Android, in this case, for Zapbox. So this work has been done before we've integrated all the vision stuff I was just showing. So this is showing us 3 degree of freedom orientation only controller tracking, but that integration is happening really soon now. And you can see that there's teleporting functionality in this little demo. And then we've got some nice bits of physics-based interaction, which is always super fun in XR experiences, especially when you've got that real physicality of six DOF controllers. So great work to shove them on all of that stuff. It's looking great. What have we got next? I think that's it from me, Kirk, for this bit. Back over to you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for taking us through everything. I hope Doug the Pug is doing okay wherever he is. Just looking at the tooling, the controllers, the demos, even the packaging, I really hope you can see how much care and thought we've put into every component of the product. And even though it's taken a long time to get there, and we did have to contend with one or two global events along the way, it was important for us to make things as good as possible in all these areas. And I guess to get to a place that puts Zapbox on the field with some really heavyweight competition and still earn its place as this affordable, easy access solution for everyone to explore the MR space. So let's talk about rollout. As you can see from this slide, our current plan is based on three phases that Simon covered. But on the Kickstarter side, I guess, again, we know how long everyone has waited in the product. We really appreciate your patience. So our number one goal is to get the boxes in the hands of the backers as quickly as possible. As Simon mentioned, our backer stock in the US is ready to go, in the UK as well. We're just waiting on the EU to complete. And because we want to make sure that everyone gets their box fulfilled at the same time, this means in reality, you should expect to see your package in just a few short weeks from now, unless something really crazy happens, like a global pandemic. I mean, what are the chances of that? And then on the software side with Kickstarter, we're launching with the Zapbox Demos app, which in this initial form will be a range of technical demos and access to other compatible content just to get you up and running. And then more importantly, an early access release of our Unity SDK that means that you can start building your own MR content in Unity, on the box, out the box. Really pleased with that bit. This is, of course, is only the start of the Zapbox journey and a pre-release for our early adopter Kickstarter backers. Both the demos, the Zapbox demo app and the Unity SDK will continue to develop and build out as we move forward and are a priority inside the company. So expect regular updates from now on. That leads us to the developer phase, which is only a couple of months later in early 2023. And that phase means the introduction of the $79 price point and a full access version of the Unity SDK and more engaging content that will really start to show the potential of Zapbox. And I'll talk about that in just 1 minute. And then finally, we want to launch Zapbox in phase three as a complete consumer product with a hub app, onboarding, customer support, and so on. But to get there, we're going to need your guys' help developing content, testing stuff out, feeding back onto your comments and opinions about what we can do better. And I guess that's why we're so happy to be talking to you today about what to expect. We've been working away in Zapper HQ long enough, and it's a pleasure to finally share with everyone and start seeing what we can all do together. So just to get a glimpse of what we've been doing here at Zapper with gaming, we're going to show you a video of our new game, snappily titled. Well, let's see if you can guess what it's called, Simon, because I think you put a, yeah, it's a guess the game moment, everybody. There's Simon and I enjoying ourselves together, yeah. Too close.
Uniform. This is because we with Quest, so we've been doing this development on Quest because we expect it to be a straightforward port, and also because Quest does work quite well. Thanks, Mark. $100 billion turns out is gets you a quite nice product. But okay, so without the world anchors, without the world anchors, we didn't have a shared origin, and so we were resetting our spaces here so that we could play co-located and kind of get the sense that we would get from Zapbox. Anyway, guess the game, right? Here we go. It is Zapbox Pool.
Zapbox Pool.
There's Abdi and I having a discussion on trying to remember what the rules of pool were. Turns out there are many different rules of pool, and we play generally a different version here in the UK from you guys across the pond. So we're going to make it American for you. It's all right. You'll be okay. I'll adapt.
So we've got a live video of this running.
We do. I need to share something different though. So it's...
So many thanks to Abdi, who's the developer on this project. He's been working on this for a couple of weeks. And our pool aces, as Simon says, were me and himself. And we recorded this live earlier on today. So what we're looking at is an alpha of the game, Simon mentioned, built in Unity and running using the pass-through on the Meta Quest. No booing, please. Under the hood, we're using Unity's cross-device XR interaction framework, which will also be supported on our Zapbox provider plugin, as Simon demoed earlier. The inputs in the controller are also the same as the Quest, so we've been able to prototype the mappings with the knowledge that they will also work directly with the Zapbox. We're using a free-floating table for now, but this would be anchored to the tabletop using the World Anchor. Just a couple of things about this game. It can be played either co-located in the same space or remotely. Full six-dog movement with the controllers. It has some basic presence in the form of track movement using our Zapbox headsets. And you'll also notice that we added some simple emoticons to get the point across when you're playing. All of the qualitative results you'd expect from Unity, so it's graphically beautiful, great physics, and we're getting pretty close now. Simon, you can explain anything else we might be seeing. It's your turn now.
Yeah, so we've had fun with it, as you can probably tell from some of the props on the side of the pool table there. So we've been playing with various mechanisms for how you would do the aiming. Initially, I was thinking that Zapbox controller is quite nice to use directly as a cue, but it ends up being a bit small to have the accuracy you need. So we've got a sort of two controller aiming scheme now, which is feeling quite good. And yeah, it's just, you know, it's just a game you want to keep playing, isn't it? Which is fun. That's definitely when we were filming this, under quite a lot of time pressure to get it recorded and edited for the talk. You know, I just wanted to beat you really, Kirk. So that was nice. And you can have those kind of emergent behaviors, like here, I picked up the chalk and I'm sort of trying to put you off by chalking your face, which is fun. It's just nice to have these kind of multi-user interactions across, well, from one end of our country to the other. Not very long in, not that many miles in global terms, but from one nation here in the King's England up to you in Scotland. This is me. Actually, I am moving here, but I'm trying to be quite precise with my aiming.
I'm trying to get in the way, I think, actually. That's
what
I'm...
You were trying to get in the way, and then I ran across and tried to blow on the ball, which is not implemented, doesn't do anything. but it was fun. And yeah, so in this room here, the table was the right size for my table. So once I positioned it on the place, I played it as I would a real table, walking around and moving with it. You can also, if you don't have that much space, you can sort of effectively teleport your user, but it's implemented by kind of spinning and moving the table. And then remote users will see you orbiting. So we have our own tables, basically. So if you were spinning your table around, I would just see you spinning around my table from my view. And then in a co-located scenario, we would probably share that table motion. So we've got very much a shared table. All right, I think that's...
Yeah, I think we're getting pretty close with pool now, so I would expect to see that in your Zapbox in the near future. Right.
And it's one that certainly for the Kickstarter...
You can do some wrap-up and some work in progress. Put your cue down and let's go.
Yeah, and so Zapbox Pool, it's fun and playable, definitely kind of pre-alpha at the moment, but it's something that we'd look to share with the Kickstarter backers kind of over the next few months, probably via test flight, private invites, that kind of thing. So yeah, keen on getting that into your hands as soon as we can. Cool, so a few more roadmappy things to talk about. What we're going to be working on in 23 when we've got through this initial launch phase. So hand tracking is something that's really interesting. This is showing running 2D landmark detection before I had my haircut on an iOS device. And this is one of those potentially device specific things because recent iPhones have made, they include what's called the neural engine, which is very good at doing machine learning models, and it doesn't use any CPU or GPU power, so it's great when you're doing XR stuff as well because you need your CPU and GPU. So our initial hand tracking work has been focusing on iOS. There are a few similar things on Android, but they tend to be different manufacturers have different SDKs, and so it's going to take a while to roll that out everywhere. So for hand tracking, expect that probably on iOS first in beta mode. interesting thing here is it's quite easy to find, well, quite easy, it's not that easy, but finding 2D points on the hand in a video is one problem, but then for XR, we need an actual 3D hand. And when devices like Quest do this, they use two cameras, so they've got already a reference for stereo in the hand. We're only doing things with one camera, so we're going to have a user calibration step, which is going to work out the physical size of your hand, and then that's going to allow us to know exactly how far away it is from the single camera we're using. And so we've been working on that kind of 3D model fitting part of the problem as well. And big shout out to Tao, who's done most of this hand tracking work for us. And this, again, is yesterday, another iPhone 12 ultra wide video. So you can see now we've got the actual hand skeleton there being solved. So solving for a skeleton position that gets the fingers in the right place. And it's not yet release quality. There are a few glitchy bits in it, but it's actually working really quite well. And we think it is going to be usable and an interesting new way to interact with stuff on Zapbox. So that's hand tracking. Because we've got the two controllers and the compatible inputs with lots of content, we are interested in being able to stream existing PC VR content. So if you've got a gaming PC on your Wi-Fi network, you'll be able to use Zapbox as effectively a PC VR headset. That's definitely one of the things that we're keen to explore. There are some, because the controller field of view for tracking is not going to be quite as high as the dedicated headsets. So it's not, until we try it, we won't know quite how compatible that's going to be with the full range of PC VR content. But certainly the kind of design tools and things where your interactions are kind of in your field of view, then I think Zapbox is a really interesting device to explore that content. Wider engine support. We started off exploring OpenXR for our initial SDK release. So OpenXR is a cross-vendor effort to standardize how people write apps for XR devices. So at the kind of the layer below Unity, making that layer more consistent across devices. And that's a great thing, and we're happy to support any efforts we can to standardize these things and make it easier to get content on more devices. Right now, OpenXR doesn't have any bindings defined for iOS, and so that was one of the challenges we faced. Unity has an OpenXR provider, but it's closed source, and that therefore, because OpenXR doesn't support iOS, that also doesn't support iOS. So in the short term, we've gone a Unity-only dedicated provider SDK, but we are keen to help to work with the OpenXR group to propose some iOS bindings to get them in the spec, and then to work with Unity to get them in the plugin, and then to live in this wondrous utopia of OpenXR everywhere. And OpenXR is already implemented in things like Unreal, so that's how Unreal accesses its XR devices. So using OpenXR at the low layer will help bring more engine and app support at the higher layers. So that is a big goal for next year too. And WebXR is the other kind of cross-device standard for how you can build content once and view it on different devices. And this for us is really interesting. There are, again, some challenges of doing this, especially on iOS, because we can't ship a browser on iOS. We have to use the web view, and we want to utilize all of that low latency stuff that I was showing you earlier. There are some challenges, but we like challenges, love a challenge. And I think there are solutions to it. So that's another thing that we'll be definitely digging into more once we've got through the launch phase.
Yep.
That is pretty much it. So we have a shiny new coming soon site on our zappar.com/Zapbox page. So you can sign up there for more updates kind of around the launch process. And that brings us to the end. Time for questions. I've also got Connell in the room with me, who's, I think, been monitoring some of the chat.
I have a question off the bat.
Okay, yeah.
Why are your queues so stubby? Why have you got a short queue in your Zappool game?
Yeah, well, yeah, I guess we could change that as a design choice. It probably dates from when we were thinking of using kind of the shorter queue anyway. That's right. The other interesting thing, actually, with these controllers, we did design this bit is separate from this bit. And so there is the thought that we could provide some free 3D printable end that would extend your Zapbox controller to a more queue-like dimension, which I think would be interesting. But right now we've got this, the two-handed control, which actually works really well. And that's going to be the nicest control mechanism out of the box.
Yeah, and in some ways, when you're in a pub, the queue being so long is an impediment. It's likely to be reversed into a fire alarm or into another pub goer or into somebody's drink. So maybe the length of a queue is a constraint rather than a pro.
Solving age-old problems.
I mean, there's just been lots of love on the chat from what I can see. Not too many questions, but love.
Oh, thanks.
Which is nice. Nice. And a huge list of attendees, which is lovely to see as well. Yeah. Any other questions from folks?
There is quite a lag, I think, on us saying things and it appearing on the stream. So we need to fill now.
Okay.
Any thoughts? Don't have anything.
I don't have anything. Can you think of any other types of Zapbox content you would like to see?
I think actually that is a good question. Very good question. So tabletop, I think, is a very underused kind of size of experience. So VR to date has been generally sit down. So kind of a seated experience that's basically 360 with thumbstick to control your locomotion, or it's been kind of room scale. And the problem with room scale and kind of Quest themselves in their adverts sort of make fun of this is people don't generally have, unless you're Zuckerberg, you don't generally have space for a like fencing court just always there available in front of your nice fireplace, right? You've usually got to move quite a lot of stuff out of the way to get usable space that you then don't bump into things. And then you've got the issue of still that, always that slight nagging doubt about how close am I to that wall in the end if I'm going to like do that. And so for me, tabletop is actually much easier to come by, a nice clear tabletop. And it's actually gets you into the kind of outside in space. So that kind of like meter cubed of content that's interactive and has, 6-12 interactions. And there are some VR existing apps like that. Like there's a one about defusing a bomb, keep talking and no one explodes, which is just, you know, there's a bomb on the table and someone has to quickly flick through a paper manual to figure out what green flashing light 4 times means or whatever. But it's, you know, the content is kind of small, but still interesting. I think there's a whole range of interesting physics-y stuff you can do on a tabletop that I'm looking forward to us exploring and also the wider Zapbox community exploring.
Yeah, and I mean, I certainly know in my tiny little cubby London flat that the bigger Quest experiences are a challenge. Whereas the kitchen table could totally host tabletop games and make a lot of sense, especially with, as you say, with the pool, where even if one of the sides of my table is against a wall and I need to play from that other side, unlike real pool, I can just like swizzle the table around and use the other side.
Simon, I can see a question for you. Okay. Someone wants to know what devices will be supporting, what's the minimum spec smartphone that will work with Zapbox to start with?
Yeah, so our it's something that, because we're still working a lot on the runtime, we're aiming to make everything work as well as we can. And I don't want to give like definitive answers at this point, especially on Android. On iOS, like every iOS device since iPhone 8 is going to be fine in terms of GPU, CPU, and cameras. They're all good. iPhone 11 Plus is great because you get the ultra wide lens built in, so you don't have to deal with the fisheye adapter. And also they have that neural engine. So any advanced features that we add further down the line that involve machine learning models will definitely work on them. On the Android side, our Kickstarter commitment was to Samsung S line devices. So that commitment remains, and those are our first targeted devices. What we would likely do on Android, because there's about, I think, 18,000 distinct Android devices on the Play Store, something like that. So we can't test them all. Samsung S line is the kind of biggest chunk, but there's such a massive long tail on Android. It's hard to, we probably haven't got your device in Zappa Towers, unless it's a Samsung S line. So we're likely to have a free, well, we've already got with the cardboard one, there's a free print at home PDF. So you can run the app when the app's available, you'll be able to run it on your device, try it out, and sort of see if the performance is meeting your expectations or not before you part with your $79.99 plus taxes and shipping.
Simon.
Yes.
Someone else just wants to know, how would you compare Zapbox to HoloLens or the HoloKit? What would you say are the key points of difference apart from the, $3,320?
Yeah, the big difference is optical versus video mixed reality. And so HoloLens and Magic Leap have optical see-through displays. So they have some kind of optical combiner. It's the fancy term for a bit of plastic basically with ways of getting light to bounce in it and out of it, but you can still look through the stack, the optical stack. So your view of the real world is direct. Your virtual content is on top. The downside of that is you can't really occlude the real world very easily. Magic Leap 2 has a layer of pixels to try and allow controllable occlusion, but it can't do very sharp edges for that occlusion boundary. So you can't have a really solid bit of content that's got very sharp edges and then seeing the real world behind you. The big advantage of those kind of optical see-through ones, though, is where you do need to actually focus on the thing in the real world, right? So if you're trying to repair a fuse box or something, then it's probably best to do that directly seeing your hands and just having little kind of overlays on the view than it is to use a camera. Because although we are pushing as hard as we can on latency and motion correction and that kind of thing, it's still just not as good as your real eyes. You wouldn't want to walk around all day wearing Zapbox. It's kind of these occasion-based things, and ideally sort of tabletop scale is the sweet spot for me for that. Quest Pro is interesting because they have gone video mixed reality as well. They have two cameras, which are positioned slightly better for where the eyes are. However, then they're still not perfect. So you can't just take those feeds and display them on the eye because they're a few centimeters in front of where they should be. So you'd still get the wrong cues for that really close-up stuff. And so they do a lot of work on, well, they have a depth map and they reproject as accurately as they can. But I don't know, I haven't tried it. So I wouldn't like to say how good it is for those kind of, you know, doing maintenance on a fuse box kind of use cases. So the downside is not as good a view of the real world, but the upside is you've got complete control of how content is mixed with the background.
So that's a great answer, Simon, but I think I misunderstood the question as well. Are you familiar with HoloKit?
Oh, HoloKit.
Yes, that was a great answer on HoloLens. I think we've got that. But what would you say is a comparable difference between us and HoloKit at this point?
I'm not sure I've seen HoloKit. I have seen a few smartphone in... Oh, thank you. Oh, yeah, that one. Yes, did see that recently. So that is phone here and a reflector. So that's an optical see-through view.
Pepper schools.
They're using ARKit for tracking, which is fine. I don't know what they're doing about interaction. I think their field of view is probably a bit lower. So it's better for those mixed... That's more of a mixed reality HoloLens type experience. I suspect there's going to be decent latency. I don't know. It's hard to know how much work they've done on things like the latency reduction. But I have used smartphone-based reflective displays in the past, and there's usually quite noticeable latency. So you turn your head, obviously you directly see the world, and then you see the content sort of move to where it should be. So it's kind of a bit floaty. And also the lack of it being... the lack of controllable opacity means it's, again, floaty. So everything's a bit ghost-like. So definitely a spectrum where if what you want to do is something mainly in the real world with a few little pop-up floaty ghost-like helpers, so like remote assistance type use cases, then I would definitely say that is more suited to an optical see-through setup. As soon as you want to go where the content is kind of the hero, a bit like the pool game, right? I want to see that pool table solidly like a pool table here. I want to be able to look up and see the world around it. And also, of course, in Zapbox, because I've got the open peripheral, I do have a direct view of my feet if I need to walk around. So Zapbox is quite interesting in that it's got that content field of view, the kind of 100-degree, bit like sitting in the front row of a cinema, kind of. So that kind of screen field of view of content, which can be camera or content. And then you've got a very natural transition into the direct view of the real world below it as well. And it's kind of interesting that Quest Pro sort of went the same way in terms of, yes, video see-through, but also opening the peripheral view too.
One thing I might just add in, if that's okay, is Zapbox is cheaper than HoloKit as well. It's just about half the price of HoloKit. And of course, Zapbox does come with the two controllers as well. So I think it's, in my humble opinion, better bang for your buck, Zapbox, than HoloKit.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, we've had internal thoughts about what if you could you keep the headset and change the little glasses element for something that has a reflective setup and still then use it with the controllers. I think our hope is we can make the video see-through mix work well enough that that is actually the product most people would want to use for most things. And then there's a question of, is it worth doing that separate reflective skew for the kind of remote assistance type use cases? No commitments, forward-looking statement. Let's finish this product first. But yeah, I do definitely see that there are use cases for optical see-through setups. But I like the Quest went video see-through because that definitely helps us talk about video mixed reality as being a thing. Nice.
Any more questions, of course, you can always get in touch with Zappar and ask away. We will do our best to reply to them. But for now, I think that's probably it. Simon, Connell, everybody else, thank you very much for your standing up performance and for your almost decent pool skills earlier on. I hope everyone's enjoyed the session and look forward to the next ones and hearing from you all soon. Thanks very much.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Enjoy Pioneers.